to live here in the 70s. It's really amazing stuff.
Wow.
It's taking me back.
I think
these hallways. This is so interesting. I did my first big session in this room.
This room?
This room. Yeah. 1976 cavity. 76, man. Jesus Christ. This is where the Beach Boys cut Good Vibrations and everything. So when I got the call to do this, I was tripping out. I was going, really? Me?
Thanks.
Out of all the cats, man? I mean, you know. So I said, how can I say no?
Thank you. You know?
So, what are we doing? I don't know what we're supposed to be doing. So you tell me what we're supposed to be doing.
Well, this is about a fucking guitarist.
He's just a bad guitarist.
Like you.
Well, me. Something like that, yeah.
Yeah, and let's play some music.
Well, we could do that. Yeah, I brought a bunch of different guitars from different eras.
Yeah, I'm gonna ask each. Well, I'm gonna ask you, what's the first guitar? Oh, yeah. So you played with Jeff, right?
I have played with Jeff, yes. One of my heroes. You did too, though, didn't you?
Yeah.
I heard that he played on one of your records.
No. I just went to his house in England.
Oh, I've been there. It's a great pad, the old castle.
Yeah.
I didn't know you guys knew each other.
Because Jim, the drummer.
Oh, because of Jim.
They know each other.
Yeah, of course.
In the 70s, you know.
Oh, okay. So, Jeff's one of my heroes, man.
2 years ago, you know, Jeff was stuck in making his own album.
Yeah.
I mean, pre-production. Mm-hmm. So he was kind of bold, you know. So Jim told him, let's go ask him, go visit and kick his ass, right? And we went there. He goes, let's jam.
Cool. That must have been fun.
No conversation. Just let's go out the, you know, that attic.
Yeah.
And old Marshall's stuck.
You know what's crazy? You walk through his house, you see like old gold record stuff in the walls, blow by blow.
Yeah.
Like, just put it in the floor, like, fuck this stuff, you know.
Sleazy. He's just a spooky place, huh?
What did you guys play?
Nothing, just jam session all day, all night.
Thank you. This is a new color, actually.
Luke.
Yeah, Music Man, Luke Guitar. They've been making guitars for me for about 10 years now.
Right.
My best friend, Sterling Ball, mm-hmm. owns the company. And the guy that used to make my guitars at Valley Arts Guitar many right. years ago, he went over to work for them, so it's essentially the same.
Oh,
well, you know, the only reason is because this it would normally be like that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It's just because it's four on this side. It's actually a full-scale guitar.
Is it?
Yeah, here.
It doesn't look like it.
It is.
It's still like red, huh?
Well, I mean, it's a new. Actually, this was the one I've been mostly using for the last few years. It's just kind of beat up,
sparkling, kind of beat up.
Well, I like it though. It's good. It's sort of like bad Hollywood showbiz color, sparkly. You know what I mean? That's where I'm at. Let me see. Here, let me give. I'll show you a couple.
You've got the old Les Paul. Yeah.
Oh yeah, this is the bad boy. This is the 59 Burst I've had forever.
Oh wow.
This is the one that you know. I play this on your record. 1980.
Yeah, yeah.
I had
yeah,
this
yeah,
back
yeah,
then.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't take this one on the road anymore because it's worth $1 million.
I know what you mean.
It's actually $500,000. It still has this great sound.
Yeah.
It's got that big fat sound, yeah. This old box, man, it's like, this is the same
guitar. Real thing, huh?
All the old Toto stuff, all the Rosanna yeah. shit that everybody likes. It. This is the same guitar. Thank you. too.
Yeah. Sounds good.
This old Les Paul is badass. Yeah. It just sings on its own, you know what I
know.
All I'm using is a little delay. I got nothing on it. You know, it's straight ahead. These gadgets are really more for looks than anything.
You don't
else.
Use amp anymore? Anymore?
Yeah, sure.
You does?
Yeah, I'm using it all over here.
Used to Marshall player.
I used to have Marshall and a Fender, those old Fenders. Mm-hmm. But I was using you. But Bob Bradshaw designed a great amp, custom audio electronics, and I'm using all that stuff right now. Where is it? That's right here. It's like a three. It's like three amps in one.
Oh, okay.
And it's powered through a VHC power amp, which splits middle. Channel is dry, no effects, straight. Mm-hmm. Then left and right just have a little whatever I put effect. In there in a stereo effect.
Oh, that's great.
So live, if it's a big hall, you don't need all that shit. Mm-hmm. Front house guy just uses mostly the straight sound. That way I can hear a little bit on stage. Mm-hmm. If you mix it all together, you're stuck with it.
I know.
Eddie Van Halen was the guy that hit me to the three speaker.
Oh yeah.
But I got some of these other guitars too. This one is a classic. Well, I was working on an ill-fated project with Jeff Beck. Mm-hmm. You know, I was producing some tracks for a record that never came out. It was some really great shit, but...
I love to hear that.
Yeah.
Well, I made How many tracks you guys did?
10 or 11.
Really?
It was right before he went into the, you know, he got into that group, The Prodigy, and he started getting into all the techno stuff. This was more of an organic record. It was
real like
Manu Katchi on drums, and Tony Imus wrote all the stuff. And anyway, we were in my studio in L.A., and he signed, this is a bastard, like, I just wanted a Telecaster, he gave me an Eddie Van Halen body, and then he signed it. So I thought that might... Sorry, but he signed the guitar, and the guys at my cartridge company took a rag and started to wash it off, and he, like, took it, and was like, oh, man.
Is that only your signature? You've got?
Yeah, I was good. Yeah,
do you have some anybody else's signature in your guitar? Just him.
Just for now.
Not for that.
This is just tuned way down. That might be not worth the hassle.
See, right?
Yeah, something like that. But this is this old guitar that this used to be my main guitar.
Oh, cute.
Yeah, it was cute. This was like really 80s, 90s thing.
I remember that.
So I was, you know, I sold some of my old guitars on eBay. Mm-hmm. For several reasons, actually. First off, I wasn't playing them. Mm-hmm. And these people need to play their guitar. These people that buy guitars and just stick them on a shelf somewhere.
Yeah.
It's kind of a shame. I had a whole bunch of stuff that I wasn't using, and the insurance is astronomical. You know, how do you insure $500,000 guitar? Like, you know what I mean? It's like
how many guitars you've got now?
Now I've trimmed down. I probably got, I don't know, a couple hundred. Yeah, but you know.
This is all you use these days.
You know, I got like some old 335s and other Les Pauls, but I just brought out the good stuff for today, the stuff that has some sort of a history.
That means at least 100 guitars, huh?
this
one guy.
Basically.
Yeah.
So I got, I pruned it down a little bit just because it was just sitting nowhere. I was worried.
I know, that's what I have to do.
Yeah, how many you got?
Yeah, it's 100 and some.
Yeah, how many of them do you play?
I know.
That's the thing. You know?
I know.
You got like your four or five main guitars, and, you know, the rest is history, you know what I mean?
I have to do something about it. I mean,
do you have a lot of old Fenders and stuff like that?
I got
a 51.
I've got a really good one, Fender 61 Strat. It's purple and matching head.
Really?
That's it.
Mm. I got a 51 Esquire around here somewhere that I.
Somewhere.
It's. Oh, whatever.
Oh, whatever. Let me hear that sound.
These strings are a little low, but yeah. This guitar a long time. It still sounds really good. Right?
Practice. That's enough.
So what do you want to talk about?
We don't have to talk about anything. Just
fuck around.
Yeah, fuck around.
Cool.
Cool.
Hey. Anybody got any water around here?
Yeah. Some, what kind of water? Drinking water or?
Drinking water. Bong water.
That's right. I was in Kentucky.
Yeah.
The folk that's open in the fridge.
Yeah.
Oh, there's the water, right?
Right.
It's called drinking water.
As opposed to. Well, you gotta understand.
What a name, you know, yeah, drinking water.
Yeah,
oh, okay.
You have to understand, here in America, man, like.
Some people don't know.
No, the water is kind of funky out of the. Nobody drinks. Everybody drinks bottled water.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes water to take a bath in, water to water your plants with, yeah. Water to drink. It's different.
Uh-huh. You see? So clearly says drinking water. Mind smoke?
No.
You quit?
No. I only like smoke at night time, okay. After a drink or two.
Mm-hmm.
Try to give my body a rest during the daytime hours.
It's really tough living in LA, I guess. It's no,
well, you can't
no,
smoke anywhere.
No smoking anywhere, huh?
You know, I smoke in my own house.
Yeah, they kill people, but they don't smoke.
Well, see, that's the thing. Isn't that the irony? That's the irony of it. You're right. I mean, you have a better chance of getting hit by a bullet than you do dying from smoking a cigarette. You might see my kids are older now.
Yeah.
My daughter smokes. She's 19.
Mine's 23.
See,
he's living in L.A. now.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Does he play?
Yeah, he does.
My son's 17 and he plays.
Oh yeah.
He's got a band. He's playing all over the Sunset Strip. And
wow.
And he's doing really well. We've been cutting some tracks for us. He writes great stuff.
My son's band just did a United States tour, like backing up, opening up Cottonmouth King.
Oh, okay, yeah. Cottonmouth. You know what that alludes to now, don't you?
No.
Cottonmouth.
Hmm.
Dry throat.
I thought so.
You know what I mean? Yeah, oh, these nutty kids today.
Well, my son's got like you all over.
Tattoos?
Yeah.
Yeah, really?
He's in Japan now.
My son doesn't smoke and he doesn't have any tattoos, but he's working. He wants to get all that shit.
How many kids you got?
Two.
Daughter and son.
Yeah. I wasn't even married when I saw you last time. I've already been divorced and have two kids that are grown up.
Oh my God.
You know, I'm remarried though. I have a beautiful, beautiful young wife.
Young
she's
one.
An actress.
Okay.
You know, Lukey did okay.
I hope so.
I'm happier than I've ever been in my life. It's kind of odd, actually. I don't yearn for the good old days or anything like that, because I'm living the good old days. Although, back in the day, though, there was something to be said about, we were talking about this earlier, like, about, you know, a lot of young cats, you know, anybody can be a rock star, but few people want to spend the years, and you have to spend the years just playing.
Practicing
and playing, as tedious as it is.
That's a.
They didn't have computers for it to
but
fix
But I think
things.
It's coming back a little bit.
I think so too.
Don't you think so? Because the kids start, it's like a computer game, you know. Once you really get into it, but gets bored after a few years.
Well.
Like that.
Yeah, I think that's probably what it is, but you know.
Well, I think there's two different ways, this computer shit and real way.
Well, the thing is, even normal people that don't know anything about music know that everybody can put it in the computer and makes it better.
I know.
And they accept it.
CDR.
You go see a pop artist live, and most of the time, you know, the backing band is all computer. And a lot of times, even the vocals are. You know? Then you go backstage at these shows, and you see like five Pro Tools rigs set up. And like,
it has names?
In tandem.
Hi, Tom.
Exactly.
Hi, Sid.
It used to be the guys in the band. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I don't know. I'm old school like you, man. We came up at the same time, listened to the same people, dug the same music.
Yeah.
Ended up sitting here in a chair.
I think we're lucky, kind of lucky.
Yeah.
Because we've seen all these great musicians.
Yeah.
In the late 60s and early 70s. 80s, 90s.
90s, and like I said, up to now, there's great songs and great records, but not, where's the great 18-year-old guitar player? Where is he? Not the guy that plays just like Stevie Ray Vaughan. There's 100 of those. But you know what I'm saying? Where's the new young voice? You know, the guy that, like, you know, where's the next Eddie Van Halen? Where's the next Jimi Hendrix or
it's over.
Jeff Beck?
I'm sorry, but it's over. Huh? Maybe some different country, like China.
Well, maybe. I mean, you know, I watch all these TV shows, late night TV shows, like the hot new bands play live. You hear them live. And that really separates it. They don't sound anything like the record.
Yeah.
It's just like the guys are scuffling through like the easiest shit.
You know, I've done this kind of guitar clinic for young kids. It's about five kids around me, like circle, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's jam, right? So most of the kids said, "Whose song is that?"
Yeah. jam. They can't just play chord changes and you know, let it flow, you know?
Yeah. So they can't jam. It's kind of sad. So let's jam. You've got a lot of, I bet we still get a lot of influence from Jeff Beck, don't we?
Sure.
It's amazing,
you
know,
it's just, I mean, I got to sit with him. I mean, I actually sat, you know, I go, what the fuck are you doing over there? And he doesn't really, he's not a schooled musician that says, oh, that's a B flat 13 flat 5 chord. You know, like, he can play all the chords. He just doesn't
know. I know, if he wants to.
And his ears are so big, man. I mean, just the way he plays, all the pick, it's all in the right hand with him, you know what I mean? You can be so expressive with your fingers more so than with the pick, you know what I mean? And his manipulation of all this shit.
Yeah, I know.
I know.
How about a hum? Yeah, that's. It makes melodies with this, yeah?
That's really hard. What's that, you know, that famous tune? Yeah.
Yeah.
Not quite it, you get the drift.
You gotta have a year. Good one.
Simon Phillips, you know Simon.
Yeah.
He'll be playing in my band now. He used to play with, he took over for Jeffrey when Jeffrey passed away. And he used to tell me Jeff used to just sit on his couch all the time, but just watching TV.
Watching TV practicing. Like,
for years perfecting that whole technique. I mean, he's just one of those guys, he refuses to play the guitar in a conventional way. I mean, that's what I respect about him.
He's still like a kid, you know?
He still really digs playing a lot.
I know.
I mean, what do you call it? Here we go. Let's try to find something here.
Fun, harmonica shit.
It's all the fingers and, you know, you just try. It's like one of his favorites that he's like, turn this all turn your finger right back here, you know, and he gets that whole other sound, you know.
Yeah, when I met Jeff, the time was over, so I had to leave. But he wanted jam so bad. No, you're not leaving, right? I said, no, I gotta go because the driver, he had to go back to London. So all of a sudden he goes, really? like high school kid, or maybe younger. All right, y'all, bye.
He lives out in the country, but I haven't talked to him in a couple of years. It's been a while.
He's fine.
It's right here. So what is this little gadget down here? What does that do?
What?
Is that just like a distortion thing?
Yeah.
I never seen it.
Powerful. Thank you.
We just jamming, man.
Yeah. Is somebody taking it?
I hope.
Thank you.
These strings are new, so I'm stretching it out a little bit here. So is this the premise of the show, to sit around fucking around like this?
That's it. That's otherwise, good. I'm not going to take this shit.
Well, I mean, don't, you know, I figured that you, this would be more of a question than answer.
Well,
Show me the coolest trick you got.
So, give me some questions.
Show me the coolest guitar trick you got. A cheap guitar trick. Not the band. I love cheap
trick. Yeah, I love cheap trick too.
No, but you know what I'm saying? You know, some stupid. It's acrobatics. It has nothing to do with, like, playing. You know,
it's well, just, like a, just let like, me just ask you
it's
something.
Like, it's like going like this. It's like if you. I thought it'd be stupid little stuff like that, you know.
Okay, well, when did you start playing guitar?
I started playing when I was 7 years old.
Seven.
Got a copy of Meet the Beatles and a guitar.
Is any influence from your brother or?
My father.
Father.
Mm-hmm. Ed Sullivan. No, my father, he was a frustrated bebop trumpet player. I never really heard him play.
Okay.
He quit, like, when I was a kid. He was in the movie business, like, assistant director.
Is he still on?
No, he's not around, man. He's been gone since 94. I miss him a lot, too.
So you start playing Beatles?
I mean, you know, like every kid, you saw Beatles on the Ed Sullivan show, and it was all over. For you guys, I don't know, when was the first time you saw them?
Ventures.
It was the Ventures.
You start from...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm the same age, man. You
know, right.
You
know, well, that's
give or take a year, but you know.
That's really big in Japan, back in early 60s, you know.
So I hear that they're
going. Well, my brothers, you know.
Yeah.
Was like, born in 40 something.
Yeah.
They start really hooking to guitars and start playing.
Yeah.
Every door.
Dick Dale.
Well,
I was
just watching my brother, you know. It's kind of piano kid. Forced me to practice piano.
Oh, yeah.
But looking at the.
Do you still read music?
Yeah,
that's good.
Not guitar, piano.
Well, it's, you know, same rules apply.
Anyway, the piano is like I have to, okay? But
so
looking after my brother, he wanted to, you know. Oh, shit. But my brother's so strict and don't even think about it, touching my fucking guitar.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he still is, though.
Did he have like an old Strat or something like that?
No, it's a real fake Japanese.
Okay.
Looks like it, yeah.
Do you still have it?
Of course I do.
I wish I had my first guitar, man. First electric guitar.
That's art.
Because my first guitar that I got with the Beatles was called a K acoustic guitar. Strings were like, you know, like that far off the neck, you know, full punishment.
More like this, right?
Full punishment guitar, man. My old man was like, you know, if you can make this thing play, we'll talk about the electric guitar.
And especially, what's it? It's the hardest song, the Beatles. No. That was a beat.
Yeah. Right there.
Yeah. That's very hard for such a guitar, right?
Leave this is mine, you know.
So, when did you start performing as a band?
Well, my first band, I was 9 years
old. Seven is too young to perform a band anyway.
No, right? I was about 9 years old when I was playing with guys that were 13.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were, and the big hot lick at the time, you know, the big set.
Yeah. Okay.
Then the Jimmy Page played that on the original record, you know.
Yeah, yeah,
but see, back in the day when we were such kids, I didn't play it right. I was going. Somebody hit me, they go, no. That's the big difference.
See, that's the biggest difference, right? When we start playing guitar, there's always guitarists there.
Yeah.
Even if it's a professional or not.
Right.
No, that's not right, you know?
Well,
we're teaching each other.
You remember,
learning
solos off of records. Mm-hmm. You pick the needle up, put it down, drive your parents completely out of their minds because you're playing the same, trying to find the same, you know?
Yeah,
And you have to go.
Yeah.
trying to pick up the lead.
I took 3 years to copy Crossroads, Eric Clapton.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's one of the greatest. That's one of the greatest.
So you performed band with her. It's kind of junior.
Yeah, yeah.
Junior
I started to get really serious about it. But by the time I was 11 years old, I was actually making money at it. Not a lot, just on the weekends playing at parties. Uh-huh. Had a little band together with some guys. And then more guys were around. So you playing whoever had a gig, that's whose band you were in.
Right.
If you had a gig at the school or, you know, we played our sixth grade graduation. Yeah. That was the first big moment, like, you know, because we could play. Like, we were playing Back in the USSR, and I played Foxy Lady. Mm-hmm. I had a fuzz and a wah-wah pill. Mm-hmm. I was 11 years old.
And, oh, wow, what a kid.
And then we, you know, and I could bullshit my way through. I wasn't playing like Hendrix. I mean, who the hell can anyway? Mm-hmm. But, you know, for the time, all the little girls screamed for us and shit like that. I said, oh, shit,
point.
Man, I'm living the dream right now.
That's a point.
I'm living the dream. All of a sudden, I was like this dorky kid, and all of a sudden, people liked me after that. They didn't pick on me because I was really small, and I was bad at sports. So they used to fuck with me all the time, you know? And then when they found out I could play the guitar, and I had that shit going on.
All of a sudden.
Now, there weren't a lot of kids my age playing. Mm-hmm. I'm sure the same with you.
Yeah, yeah.
You were kind of a freak of the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Like, wow, look at that kid can play. Even before I knew what my dick was for, like, I was playing a guitar, you know what I mean?
Yeah, back then, yeah, everybody could play at least chord C.
Well, yeah, you had to learn all the standard. Yeah. You know, yeah. Maybe. Back machine.
Oh my god.
We're showing our age here, Chuck. People thought that Tina Turner did that first.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Then when Jimmy came along, the whole ball game changed.
Which one? Page or Hendrix?
Hendrix first. Well, I got into Hendrix first. Well, yeah, you know, Hendrix came and you know, the first time you heard it. I was in 1967, man. I was like
still
9, 10 years old, you know? And if you knew how to play this chord.
Yeah, sharp nine, yeah.
You call it the sharp nine, you call it the Hendrix E.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We call it the Hendrix E. Regularly, it was like this, you know? Or
yeah.
Like.
Yeah, yeah.
That had an edge.
Sharp nine,
yeah. That had an edge to it, man, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
that was the shit,
first,
you know?
First time I played this chord, I go, oh my god, I'm Hendrix.
Yeah, for all day long.
Yeah,
all day long.
Yeah, even a Foxy or a Purple Haze or
all that. Yeah. And then I had to open up the whole other, you know, and then there's it. I still think it's one of the greatest guitar solos ever recorded. Mm-hmm. That live crossroads.
Have you ever seen Hendrix alive?
No, man. I was supposed to go see him at the Hollywood Bowl.
Oh, really?
But my parents saw pictures of him and, you know, they said, like, no, you're too young to go off of this stuff. I would have shit to see Jimmy, man. Uh-huh.
So that's a really early 70s, right? So you're already a professional in
well,
the 70s.
I was mid-70s. Mm. I mean, my high school band was like me and Michael Landau on guitar.
Oh, really?
And John Pierce, Steve Picaro. Mm-hmm. Jeff Picaro, David Page, and Carlos Vega.
Oh, they're in the same school or just same area
yeah,
kids?
Same. Well, we all went to the same school. David Page went to another school.
Mm-hmm. In L.A.
But they met through their fathers who were doing the Glenn Campbell show.
Okay.
Glenn Campbell's another great guitar player. He sat in this room a whole bunch back in the 60s, man. Mm-hmm. This was the very room where so many hit records were made. I mean, they purposely left the floors and everything funky. Mm-hmm. This is what it looked like back in like 1967. You know what I mean?
I know this are black.
Look at all this
Indian
old,
look,
old school,
it's
man.
Kind of hippie, yeah. Look at the speakers.
I mean, look. When was the last time somebody used those speakers? You gotta be kidding me. You know what I mean? That's some really old school shit right there.
So you started performing with these kids, Cats.
Yeah, I started playing these in high school. That's when I became aware of what a studio musician was, because I never knew what that was.
Same here.
You know what I mean? I thought, well, what is that? I mean, I thought the monkeys actually played, you know? Well, I was crushed when I found out. I figured that. I was looking at their hands and go, this doesn't look right.
I know. I know.
Only Mike, the guitar player, he's the only guy, he actually played the chords.
Mike Nesson,
looked like he was playing. But the other cats,
just,
the other cats were scuffling, and you know, they all sang. They did really sing. Mm-hmm. I used to go out with Mickey's daughter, Amy. We were good friends anyway. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen her in years. She's a beautiful girl. but I got to hang out with him. Mickey's a really cool. I'll ask her. Recorded in this very room right now. Really possible that could have been recorded right here. those are great, but all those guys were session players. Tommy Tedesco, Louis Shelton played guitar. That Glenn Campbell played on all those records. Glenn was a number one session guy before he got his own thing together.
Okay.
So anyway, I found out about all these guys. Larry Carlton, who was one of my heroes and somebody that I get a chance to work with all the time. I've known him since I was 17. Mm-hmm. I used to go hang out at his house, and because Jeff Bacar was playing with him at the time. You know, they did all the Steely Dan records, and Steely Dan was like, we were like a Steely Dan cover band in 1972. Landau and I played all the guitar parts, you know, and we had vocals together the whole thing. Steve Bacar was a relentless band leader, rehearsing us with the vocals and all that stuff. We had two singers besides all of us.
Wow.
And Jeff used to come down and play with us even when he was in Steely Dan, because he was 3 years older than me. And Donald Walter came and saw one of our high school gigs, and we were doing all Steely Dan songs.
Oh, wow.
And he was like, and they were like going, we should just hire these guys to stay home.
Lucky boys and girls.
I had a very lucky life. I mean, growing up in Los Angeles, around musicians of that caliber. I mean, Jeff Bacar was already a legend when I was still in high school. And like, you know, just to get to play with him and all those guys, I mean, that was like the pinnacle of where you could be at. And then I started getting to doing demo sessions for people, you know? Because I was studying, we were all studying rapidly at that time. Landon and I used to practice together. We used to, you know, we'd take private guitar lessons. I was taking orchestration and arrangements. And, you know, we were just like going to improvisation school in LA, and you'd meet all these other musicians. And we were all really hungry and really dedicated for it. And yeah, an opportunity, you know, knocked on the door. I was very, 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 very lucky, man. Just to be at the right place at the right time.
It's not happening right now?
There's no scene anymore. Okay. I mean, back when, you know, in the 70s when I started doing this stuff, you'd walk in there and go, who do I get to play with today, man? Oh, Jeff's on the drums. I mean, who's playing keyboards? It'd be like, you know, Michael Lamartine or somebody like that. You go, and you get to meet, or Steve Gadd was in town from New York with Will Lee, and you were playing on a session with those guys because you read, wow, I'm a big fan, love your music, and then you become friends. And then guys from England would come in, you know, guys from Nashville, and everybody would play together, and you get to meet everybody. But nowadays, everybody just, you know, if you do any sessions at all, it's like you show up and overdub. Nobody really plays all at the same time. Now, when I make my own records, and I'm sure you're the same way.
Of course.
We play at the same time.
I
need to get a vibe in a room. You know, if somebody plays some lick, then you start. There's no improvisation. Everything's just cut and paste.
Yeah.
I was talking to some, you know, David Williams, guitar player. He used to play with Michael Jackson, fun guitar player. We used to do Quincy Jones sessions together back in the day. He said, you know, he's a black cat, and he's doing, like, rap records and stuff now, and like, they'll go in, he'll just play for, like, you know, the verse and the chorus, and they'll stop and say, okay, that's cool. He goes, no, man, I want to play it through the whole song. have to be the same exact thing every time, you know?
These cats
don't get it, you know? It's like they don't understand that with us, you had to capture a performance. And then if you fucked up, you could go back and maybe punch in what's wrong. You know, not to say that everybody was flawless, because that wasn't the case, but, you know.
Well, Pro Tools is kind of...
It's a great tool.
It's a great tool, yeah.
It's wonderful.
As a toy.
I mean, to be able to, like, do non-destructive editing, and, you know, have a million tracks and never have to worry about it. Recalling mixes, you know, you can move comping vocals and stuff like that.
Yeah,
it's great, but, I mean, if you can't play, you can make somebody sing and make... You can make somebody who has no talent sound like they got the shit going on.
It's just the most expensive toy.
Like there's this, I got this recording studio in the Valley, right, called The Steakhouse. And a lot of young people work in there. And like these drummers are going there and they're scuffling through the parts, man, you know what I mean? They're just barely making it.
And then they
get up and go like, hey, that's fine, man, just Pro Tool it. And then some guy would like spend all night long, you know, putting everything together and fixing it. The guy comes back the next day and he sounds like a genius. He goes, see, I told you. It's like, guys, I mean, you know, you just have to put some sweat in there.
Yeah.
You know, you got to sit in there and fucking like, you know, until you get it right, you know? play it 100 times if you have to.
That's why it's really hard to find a real musician these days, you know, because there are so many, it's like, you're different, because they're even our age, they do the Pro Tools shit, some people, you know. HR, man, we live in a 21st century, man. Leave up to me, Messer. Come on, you know.
My answer to them is always, but can you play?
Yeah.
Really, take all the shit down. Yeah, use it all, please. Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful, we all use it. Why not? But still, the bottom line is like, you know, we actually played the shit.
Yeah.
It gives you more options, more choices and stuff. And then also, then what was happening in the 70s, we also got into all that heavy, like, progressive prog rock stuff. Early Genesis, Yes, the Mob Vishnu Orchestra, all that. Lynn. You know, all those wacky, you know. Yeah, all that wacky shit.
And sometimes,
you know, all that. Where is this? Is some classic.
That's Mahavishnu.
Yeah. It was really. Those are very much exercises in getting your chops. That's when Super Chops first hit. You know, and you. Yeah. Have you ever played with Al Di Meola before?
So after the Mahavishnu, I've quit.
No, man, you can't do that. Me and Simon had a band together that we did all Mahavishnu and Jeff Beck stuff, you know, all this mid-70s, But Al's fun with it.
Yeah. He plays with the fingers, right?
No,
the picks. Super thick picks.
It's funny.
I like that.
I still love playing the guitar. Get up and play every day, try to every day.
It's kind of 90s, it's the late 80s, you know, it's all the synthesizer took all over the place, you know?
Yeah, Roger Lynn, the guy invented the drum machine that changed the face of music forever, he was a guitar player. He was Leon Russell's guitar player.
I know.
And engineer. And he just took apart one of those
Intruder.
Rolling, you know, beatbox things. And he one day went, what if I did this? And I saw the very first drum machine, one, Roger Lynn, the Lynn Drum 1. It's still in pieces. Like, it looked very much like, remember Bill Gates, that you see the movie when they made their
Home
computer,
big one,
made out of like wood and real cheesy wood. And it would look very much like that with like wires coming out of it. But it worked. You go boof, baff, boof, boof, baff. I'll never forget the look on Jeff Beccaro's face when he heard that for the first time. He goes, I'm taking that motherfucker and I'm throwing it in the pool right now. No one should ever hear this. And you know what? He was right. It changed. It was more like this. It was more like, you know, like. All of a sudden, drummers are fucking out of work. Then you had to become a programmer. Even great drummers. Like, what would you want to have Jeff Beccaro program your drums?
I know.
Wouldn't you want to have him play?
I know.
Because it's so much funky.
It's sad.
But that whole music, but you know, you go back and listen. I watch VH1 classics. Sometimes I get drunk and watch like old videos, and I see some of my old shit when I was a kid. I go, oh God, what was I thinking with the hair and the whole bit?
Yeah.
But you hear that plastic synthesizer, Flock of Seagulls kind of. Like, it's just awful.
Corny, you know?
It doesn't really stand the test of time well. There were some bad periods in there. There was some great stuff in there too. Don't get me wrong, it wasn't all crap, but
I was really bummed out.
Those English synth, but here in my car, I wanna drive and dance.
I like that.
It's just like wow, and you see this stuff now, and you just laugh. I find it, and even my kids, my son especially, you know, we're like best friends. He's always hanging with me, wants to hear the new shit and all that. And I sit there and go, check this out.
He laughs.
He's looking at me with the hair, you know, like, and the whole thing.
What the fuck
and
is this?
He's like, going, Dad, man, what's with that? What is
which
that?
Which era?
Yeah, what is that? How, what year was that? How old was I? Was I still here? Was I here at all? You know what I mean? It's pretty funny. And then here we are making records, and here we are 25-some-odd years later sitting in front of each other. Man.
Seems like yesterday. Play some minor blues.
Yeah. What are you gonna do? And the best chord ever?
How was that?
Minor major seven?
The crazy chords.
the adult chords.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure, this chord progression is really cool. You know the movie called Baghdad Cafe?
Yeah. Baghdad Cafe, yeah.
That song?
Yeah.
It's fucking great, huh? I didn't know that. It's kind of rockabilly guitar.
He's very unique, man. He's got that rockabilly thing on him, but he's got more chops than any of those
guys.
I
know.
Nice guy. You ever met Brian? Real nice guy.
Yeah.
Hot right here. Hey, also take all the yeah.
It's nice. Yeah, it's nice, huh?
Yeah, just all that stuff, you know, the chord melody stuff, you know.
Yeah. You get job. You get gigs.
You know, there.
Oh!
There's a cute one of those right here somewhere, huh? I forgot. Where is it? Oh.
How do you discover this thing?
So, what do we need to do? We've done it. We've got like 8 million hours of stuff, you know?
Okay.
Are we cool?
大丈夫ですか? 大丈夫?
Do you want to say goodbye or something, so you have some wrap up or something?
Whatever.
Exactly. There it is. That's all you got.
Yeah. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you very much, my friend. It's great to see you again. Good to play with you as well.
Thank you.